Ladies and gentlemen, welcome everyone. I understand it doesn't start till the gavel goes. And now I hope we're on. Welcome to everyone that's here and everyone that's watching this on TV. And we're glad to have you with us for the October 20th City Council meeting, City of Gastonia. I would at this time like to ask Mayor Pro Tem Brenda Craig for the opening prayer, after which we will stand for Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. Before she does, there's a habit that I've had and saying many times we would like to do this. Certainly, we don't want to do it for anybody, but we feel that we should, I feel we should do it to folks that have just really, really worked so hard and meant so much to this city. And we could go today. The Honorable Judge Ralph Jingles passed away fairly suddenly with heart. The city was were represented there at the service yesterday. Left his children, wife, and just a wonderful fellow. He was his chief district court judge for Gaston County, and he was 69 years old. Been here all of his life. Some of us have known him all of his life, and so our lives. So I wanted to certainly say that the city and all, everyone involved with the city of Gastonia sends their deepest condolences to Skip and to certainly to his family. And there were some very kind things said to him about him yesterday. At this time, if call on Mayor Pro Tem Craig, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to serve the citizens of Gastonia on this governing body, and to have had the honor in serving with my fellow council members for the past 4 years. I pray for Dave, Jim, John, Todd, and Porter as they begin to prepare themselves for the years ahead. I pray, O Lord, that you will bless them with your peace and love them as you continue to guide them in your way. O Lord, I also pray that as Walt moves on to newer things, that you will always bless him and his family with your peace and love. God, grant them the serenity to accept the things they cannot change, the courage to change the things they can change, and the wisdom to know the difference. In your holy name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. Thank you very much. We'll proceed on with the agenda for the, may I have approval of the adoption of the agenda, please? Is there a second?
Second here, sir.
Discussion? All in favor? Right hand, please. Thank you. Approval of the minutes of the regular council meeting of October the 6th, 2015. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Moving right along. All in favor? Raise your hand, please. Thank you. Okay. Item F, item E is Award Ceremonies and Promotions Committee proclamation recognizing. And I want to say Michael, but I don't think that's right, is it, David? Smolin, for tireless dedication to his sport and for his world-class skill and sportsmanship. And we'll hear more from Dr. Curlin making the presentation at this time. If the gentleman would come down, please.
Good evening. Would you like to bring your family up here? Is also any other supporters and members of the kayak community that might be with you tonight? Good to see you.
Oh, very much.
Yeah. How are you? Well, it gives me great pleasure to to speak of this proclamation today about Michal Smolin. I've watched Michal for several years in a very indirect fashion because my son-in-law has been involved with kayaking for several years in the past, and so we've had a chance to see Michal practice as well as race, and we've always been great supporters and proud to see him excel and advance. And so this proclamation speaks volumes to that, and so I'll just proceed with the proclamation. Whereas in September 2015, kayaker Michal Smolin, a 2011 graduate of Ashbrook High School and a second-year undergraduate student at Belmont Abbey College, joined athletes from around the world to compete in the 2015 ICF Canoe Slalom World Championships in London, England. And whereas Michal Smolin finished the men's K1 final with a time of 92.01, just over 3 seconds behind the gold and silver medal winners, earning the bronze medal and marking Team USA's first men's kayak world championship medal in 16 years. And as a five-time USA national team member, the world championship medal is the latest in a string of accomplishments for Michal, including winning the gold medal at the under-23 world championships and becoming the World Cup bronze medalist in Prague. And whereas since he was 10 years old, Michal has been training to reach the highest level of athletic competition in the world. And he continues to train at the U.S. National Whitewater Center, following in the footsteps of his father, Rafał Smolin, who, as a former member of the Polish national team and head coach of the 2012 U.S. Olympic slalom team, and whereas in the spring of 2013, Michal became a United States citizen and gained eligibility to represent the United States at future Olympic Games. And in April and May of 2016, Michal will compete in the Olympic trials and anticipates making his first Olympic team in Rio de Janeiro. Therefore, be it resolved that the mayor and city council do hereby recognize and commend Michal Smolin for his tireless dedication to his sport and his world-class skill and sportsmanship, and wish him well on his efforts to become part of the United States of America Olympic team in the Rio de Janeiro 2016 Olympics. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused the seal of the city of Gastonia to be affixed this 20th day of October, 2015. John D. Bridgman, Mayor. Would you like to say a few words just about your experience and things are going?
Thank you, Dave. It's an honor to receive this recognition, and it's also an honor to be able to represent my country, my state, and the city of Gastonia as I compete internationally. And heading into the next season especially, I am thrilled to have the recognition and support of the city of Gastonia as I prepare for the Olympic Games. Thank you.
Would you like to,
Congratulations. We'll keep up with you.
Congratulations. We're proud of you. Thank you, Liv.
Best of luck to you.
Next.
First. Thank you, Dave.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going into the item F of presentations, and I'm going to make a presentation shortly of the Troop 19. If you would certainly bear with us just for a few minutes, I am going down to the podium, and I would like to ask the council, and Mr. Smith would like to come to come down. Ladies and gentlemen, you notice I brought everything I ever knew with me right here. I think I'd do better, make more sense that way. This is not pleasant. This is not, actually, we voted it down. It didn't mean anything, but we voted it down unanimously at the last meeting. 26 years ago, a young lady came into City Hall, and she hasn't left. She's been there's her name right there, Virginia Creighton, city clerk. And these ladies, of course, are filling in for it, but this is the city clerk and the new city clerk, Sherry Dunaway and Regina Phillips. This young lady that came in 26 years ago, boy, she's having a fit already. And I knew she would. Jenny Creighton, she has been absolutely remarkable. She has been the biggest asset for Gastonia and a lot better than a lot of us that have been here longer and back and forth. But she's worked so hard. She's so dedicated. She's always cheerful, always generous. Never heard her say anything mean about anybody unless it was when I left or something, but all y'all left. But anyway, we are going to miss Jenny Creighton so much. We'll continue on. We'll continue being the city. But we have good people. We have wonderful people. But Jenny, I want you to come up, and you don't really have to say anything. We'd like for you to, but I'd like to make a presentation.
Time?
Yeah. Okay. This is just a token of our appreciation for everything that you've done for us in 26 years, which is most of your life. So thank you very much for that. And I think that some others might want to say a word or two. If you would like to say anything, you certainly are welcome to go first.
No, you said I never said anything bad, but now here it comes.
Here it comes. It's coming back. Well, here it is.
Thank you very much.
I'd sort of like to hear.
Yes, we are.
Be the same. I feel like we're sending Dorothy home.
Yeah.
Okay. He's innocent.
That's why you were left out of it.
I was supposed to keep anything like this from happening.
Yeah.
Good job.
We know how to get around you.
May I please have a standing ovation for and an applause for him. Say anything? Have we done? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Great presence.
There's
two little boulders from
there. And my agenda.
He's got a special.
Scout, I ought to have been prepared. So, okay. I would at this time like to, under the presentations of item F, I would like to congratulate two young men on accomplishment of Eagle Scout, and I have from the office of the mayor to them letters to read, and I would like to ask Timothy W. Norris II come forward. I'd like to ask Eagle Scout Harrison J. Greer to come forward, and then behind them, I'd like for the troop and the Scoutmaster to be with them.
Of course.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Let them get up, and I'll just these gentlemen. They're from Trinity United Methodist Church. Is the troop 19. Okay, this is to Ken. This is to Eagle Scout Timothy W. Norris II, Gastonia. Dear Eagle Scout Norris, on behalf of the City Council of Gastonia, I'd like to personally congratulate you on your accomplishment of Eagle Scout through your involvement and leadership in Boy Scout Troop 19, Two Rivers District of the Piedmont Council, which meets at Trinity United Methodist Church, Gastonia. Your dedication and hard work, truly commendable. For your Eagle Scout project, you constructed a horse shelter at Bed of Hope Ranch in Gastonia. The horses at Bed of Hope Ranch unselfishly provide hope and healing to individuals who are struggling to overcome some of the same challenges the horses have experienced. The horses are an essential part of Bed of Hope Ranch, and each horse has a job and a purpose. Caring for these horses is huge responsibility, and by building this shelter, you've contributed to the mission of Bed of Hope Ranch to reach, rescue, and restore hurting children, families, and horses through programs that build mind, body, and spirit. You have persevered in accomplishing your goal, and your efforts are much appreciated. Your thoughtfulness and creativity make our community a better place to live, work, and play. The City Council and I salute you, Timothy, for your accomplishments and wish you continued success in the future. Sincerely, John Bridgman, Mayor. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. His dad's proud leader, the Scoutmaster. There he is. That's him, number one. Yep. Him, number two. Yep. Very proud. So. Harrison? Yes. Eagle Scout Harrison J. Greer. Yes. See, I know how you shake hands. People don't shake. Is it still? Okay. On behalf of the City Council of Gastonia, I would like to personally congratulate you on your accomplishment of Eagle Scout through your involvement and leadership in Boy Scout Troop 19, Two Rivers District of the Piedmont Council, which also meets at Trinity United Methodist Church in Gastonia. Your dedication and hard work are truly commendable. Your Eagle Scout involved planning, leadership, and physical completion of a project benefiting Forest Heights Elementary School. Through your efforts, you oversaw the installation of three concrete block flower beds, and you restored an existing flower bed. Also, you improved the appearance of the school grounds by cleaning up the yard, and you weeded and edged the curbing. You want to go on with me? I got it. You have persevered in accomplishing your goal and your efforts in making our community a better place to live, to work, and to play. It's very much appreciated. The City Council and I salute you, Harrison, for your accomplishments and wish you continued success. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's so good. Anything you want to say, either one of you? Okay.
Thank you.
What I would like to do is, now that you met these gentlemen, let's let the other members of the, as you are going back to your seat, come up and just give your name. We know what your name and where you go to school, and we know what troop you're in. And then go by and you gentlemen go by and shake hands with the council.
Let us know your rank.
And let us know your rank. that came from somebody. You want to go first.
Congratulations. Good job.
Well, yeah. Name, school, and ask.
Congratulations. Name, great school, job.
Yes, sir. Good enough. You want to come? Go ahead.
Excellent job. Thank you. I'm Bailey Greer, and I am in PAC 11, and I am homeschooled.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're the younger brother of Harrison Greer.
Harrison Greer's brother. Okay. All right, sir.
My name is Prem Gandhi. I'm from PCCS, and I'm a Star Scout.
Great. Great. Mm-hmm.
Great. My name is Edward Salcedo. I go to PCCS, too, and I'm a Tenderfoot.
Tenderfoot. Great. Come on, Tenderfoot.
My name is Trevor Wiggins. I go to PCCS also, and I am a second class.
Great. Thank you, sir.
I'm Preston Greer. I'm a Tenderfoot, and I am homeschooled.
Great. Preston? Step out a little closer.
I am Alan Hawkins, and I go to Southwest Middle School, and I am second class.
Great. Thank you.
I am Dustin Welch, and I go to PCCS, and I am Tenderfoot.
Tenderfoot.
My name is Selvin Lindos. I go to Gassner Early College High School, and I am a Life Scout.
Nice. That's nice.
My name is Marcus Olive, and I go to H.H. Beam Elementary, and I'm a Scout Troop.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your, what you do.
Please, guys.
Thank you. Okay. Great. Mr. Tim Morris. Norris.
Thank you for all you're doing for those boys.
Master, I know it's more than 2 hours a week.
I want you guys to know, and your Scoutmaster, that the City Council and I are very, very proud of what you do, and keep it up, and don't quit, don't stop. We're very proud of you. Item F, number two, under the presentations, is Ms. Farrah Brackett, Gastonia Christmas Parade Chairman, references request for in-kind services, Gastonia Christmas Parade, December 6, 2015. Santa's coming. So are you here, Farrah? Yep, there you go. Okay. There's somebody following you there.
He's on backup.
Oh, okay.
Ms. Ferris Brackett is the chairman this year. My name is Chris Ashley. I chaired it last year. We're asking the city for in-kind services for the Gastonia Christmas Parade. Last year we moved it to Main Avenue with overwhelming success. We heard a lot of very good things about the move to Main Avenue. With that, we plan on keeping it there. It seemed like everything went smooth. The city police department, the fire department, and services were all fantastic last year. And with that, we thank you all and open up to any questions you have on the parade.
Yes, sir, Mr. Pearsall.
It looked like everything's about like it was last year, the route and everything.
Yes, sir.
At this time, I'd make the motion that we provide the in-kind services for the
second
downtown
second
Christmas parade.
Let me say that it almost, some of us, brings back memories the way you came down Franklin. It was shorter. I mean, Maine. It was shorter, but it was cozier and more. It seemed like more like a Christmas parade.
It had that atmosphere.
It did have that atmosphere. And I think this year, there's a lot. This changes in 1 year, and it'll be even cozier, even better. So thank you for what you do. Some of us have done that for many years, and so we're glad to see you back up on Main Street.
Do you remember when the Christmas lights were strung from one side of the street?
Yes, sir.
With the star in the middle.
With the star in the middle. I miss that.
Yep, remember it well.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? You've got a motion, and did we get a second?
We did.
Okay. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor of, raise your hand, please. Okay? It's unanimous. Thank you both very much. Appreciate what you do. I got some scouts that'll be in the parade with you. Okay. That's all we have under the presentations. The item G is public expression. I have two to speak. Mr. Randy Kistler, 2807 Kennedy Road, Gastonia. Topic is the baseball park. Mr. Kistler.
I'm just coming to speak. I live at 2807 Kennedy Road, Gastonia. Citizen, voter here in the city. Reading a lot in the paper of recent about heavy support of a new baseball stadium being built in different locations, and talking about how much support there was for it and everything. And I differ. I'm here to say that they're going to be heavy opposition against this stadium. I don't think we can afford this stadium, our city. I don't think it's in need of right now. And I'm actually blown away by, this is October, and June or July of this year, this building was full of city employees, hard-driven career officers out here coming in here and having to stand up for themselves for a pay freeze that was implemented 4 or 5 years ago that put hardship on families' lives, officers' lives, people who are serving this city. And then we come here several months later, and we're talking about spending money on a ballpark. It blows me away to see that. The repercussions of this pay freeze, it's not over yet. Chief Helton, it's going to take time to recover from this. You replaced one of the most respected, you defunded and disassembled one of the most respected police departments in this state. They recognize all over this country. And now it's going to take a while for him to recoup, retraining. It's going to take money to retrain these new officers. And we reaping the repercussions of it, our sniper conference. Event in this city that drew more people, more tourists for hotels, restaurants across this city than any event we have. And we were not able to have it this year because of these cuts in the budget for the police department and the pay freezes and the dismemberment of this department. We got all kind of projects here in this city that have went bad, we look at the Nick's Steakhouse, how many times we sold that, and then we ended up selling it to a lowest bidder. We look at this hotel, we've already reading things about how things are going wrong, not going good there. Is the city going to have to bail that out now? And the Civic Center, how many times have we replaced the people that run the Civic Center now? Just failed programs, and after all this had went down, with the police department and all this with Nick's and everything, I really thought this city council would replace our city manager. I think you had grounds to replace him. They knew, he knew, the mayor knew about these pay freezes and how it was affecting these guys and this department 4 years ago. And I won't repeat some of the comments that was made by those two. I didn't hear them myself, so I won't repeat them. I know well-respected business owners out here that made those comments about how y'all felt about those pay raises 4 years ago. You had gentlemen out here, you had people out here. I know I served for 7 years as a volunteer at that police department. I know firsthand, I know those guys really well, a bunch of them. And I know one young man, he spoke here. He went 2 winters without heat in his house. Mr. Munn, how many people in your neighborhood went without heat for 2 years because of your budget? I see all across this, I see these signs, people running for new office. And some of them saying, common sense government. I think what I've seen lately, I've seen special interest government. I do not think a new baseball stadium, I don't think selling Nick's Steakhouse to the lowest bidder just because it fits your clientele, I don't think that's common sense government. I think that's special interest government, and I think that needs to be stopped. Baseball stadium is not going to help the people on South New Hope Road that need sidewalks, these streets that need repaving. That's not going to help that a bit. Guys, I hope you do what's right. But don't think you're going to come in here and strong arm and have a baseball stadium down here built. There are plenty of oppositions around this city against this baseball stadium. I'm all for sports. I love baseball. But it comes a time, who's next? What department's going to come in here 3 years from now that you can't afford to pay? You got to cut pay scales to pay because you're paying for a baseball stadium or a project of your own. Solely against it, guys. Do what's right. Keep the money out of the budget to pay you employees, to treat the employees of this city right. Thank you.
The next one on the list is Mr. Don Barkley, 3101 Whitson Road. I did not mention earlier to those who maybe have or are not familiar with the public expression that is 5 minutes, and of course the I did mention it before, Mr. Kistler, that we don't respond and are not supposed to respond through the to the presentation. Mr. Barkley?
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, I'd just like to touch on three topics briefly. This past weekend, there was a nice article in the front page of the Gazette about Firestone. But it was not the mill, it was the Mill Village. And when I read that, I thought about something that came up several years ago with the Thread Trail people. I'm not for trails, I'm not opposed to trails. I was opposed to the presentation when they came, both the city and the county, and the question came up about condemnation. No, they would not condemn. Well, of course they're not. They don't have the authority. But guess who voted to condemn when it came down to it? It was the city of Gastonia. Now, I suppose the city has some support for this project of the houses up at Firestone. But have you looked at the end result? Will you be called on to take away somebody's house to give it to a developer? I'm just posing the question. I don't expect an answer. Like you say, you do not answer at public recognition. I think that's fair because you never know what the subject's going to be when somebody gets up at public recognition. But Mr. Munn, as you said several months ago when the subject came up, Mr. Munn will let us know later on. And I'm just wondering, do you want, as in the condemnation for the Greenway, the vote was 3-3. I know who voted for it. I know who voted against it. It was an open meeting. The mayor wrote, Mayor Stoltz broke the tie. But do you want Mr. Munn to let me know the position of the city or the position of each council member on this subject? Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You do understand the question.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you for your time. You. Have a good meeting.
Thanks, sir. Next item is the consent agenda. Is there a motion to approve items 1-4 of the
consent? So moved. Consent?
Is there a second?
Second. Second.
Discussion? All in favor, raise your hand, please. It is unanimous. Virginia. Item 5 is the under the regular agenda is a request for funding of Gaston County Children's Advocacy Center, Division of Prevent Child Abuse, Gaston, Inc. This item was continued from the June 16th, 2015 City Council meeting in order for additional information to be provided. Presentation is Ms. Dottich here, Executive Director of Prevent Child Abuse, Gaston. Hello.
How are you?
Welcome.
Good. I'm just going to give you a little bit of an update since June, and then I'm here to answer your questions.
Okay.
Since June, well, actually, I'm going to say since the beginning of the year, we have now provided services as of the end of this week to 137 children. That's two less than what we served all of last year. In 2014. We have also submitted our accreditation application for national accreditation from the National Children's Alliance. We have attended training at the Children's Advocacy Center of North Carolina's symposium on child abuse and neglect. There were 10 members of our MDT from Gaston County who attended that symposium, so we had a good showing. We have been extremely busy, especially since school started back. And in the last 3 weeks, my child advocate is here, and we have averaged about 8 interviews a week. So the need for a forensic interviewer dedicated to the CAC is definitely there. And I'm here to answer your questions.
Any questions, Ms. Shear? Comment? Yes, sir. Mr. Kimball?
First off, ma'am, I believe you indicated that you had submitted documents for accreditation.
Yes.
Do you have any idea if you are going to be accredited or what the process lies ahead?
The process for that, the timeline for that, is that about a month after they receive the application, they come back and they tell me if I need to make any kind of modifications. We have already been given the confirmed a site visit date of March 9th.
Okay.
They usually have a site visit about 6 months out. And then after that site visit, if we pass the site visit, then it is presented at their next board meeting, which would be in June of 2016. And that is the earliest that we would be accredited. And that is the normal accreditation timeline or the National Children's Alliance.
Two brief follow-up questions, madam. Number one, have you received any funding from Gaston County?
From Gaston County?
That's correct.
In 2015?
Yes.
No, I have not.
Okay.
They have committed to giving us $10,000 a year for the next 5 years.
Okay.
But I have not received the funds yet.
Okay, and how about any other public entities, governmental entities? Have you received any funding from those agencies?
The Governor's Crime Commission grant, we were awarded. Oh. We did meet all of their modifications, so we are definitely going to get that. But as of this date, I have not received any. That is a reimbursable grant, meaning the funds have to be expended up front, and then they reimburse them. We were notified by Dina Joy, who is the Children's Advocacy Center of North Carolina Executive Director, last week, that the federal government released the funds to the Governor's Crime Commission.
Okay.
I'm not exactly sure of the date. We were told that we would be receiving our contracts, and I'm talking about all CACs, all government entities that are part of this grant process. No one across the state has received their contracts yet, but we would be receiving them in the near future. So I'm checking the mailbox every day.
Thank you very much. That's all I have, Your Honor. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Toddy, have you gone to any other city councils within Gaston County and asked them for monies?
I have not, because I started with the county in March, and then I came to y'all in June. And since I have been here, I have worked on the accreditation application and 4 grants. All 4 of those grant applications have been submitted, and I'm waiting to hear back from them. And they're for different things. But I have not been to any other city council yet, because I simply have not had time yet. The accreditation application, most CACs work on that for about 6 to 8 months. I completed the application in 6 weeks.
Wow.
That's nice. And you are a nonprofit. Is that correct?
Yes, we are a nonprofit.
503C.
We are a 501C.
A 501C.
C3.
Sorry. Working on accreditation. Okay, yeah, that's it for me.
Okay.
Ms. Gregg?
Dottie, thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you, Brenda.
I know all the paperwork that's involved in all that. The four grants that you've applied for?
Yes, ma'am.
And it is the Governor's Crime Commission grant one of those four?
No.
Okay. So if you take those four grants and the Governor's Crime Commission grant, and how much would that totally equal?
I have to stop and think. None of them cover this position.
Right. I understand that.
I haven't totaled it up in my head, to be honest. The Community Foundation grant that has been awarded to us was, I can tell you what each one was, but I haven't totaled it, so.
Okay, that's fine.
The Community Foundation grant is for just over $5,700, and that's for equipment.
Right.
The Wells Fargo grant was for just over $1,800, and that's also for equipment. I have a Blumenthal grant application that's outstanding that is just under $25,000.
And what does that use for?
That is to cover, that's another position that we have in Prevent Child Abuse Gaston. It's for a part-time prevention specialist and to cover a part-time office manager for us. And also there's training equipment, and it also covers some of our operating costs, because the Governor's Crime Commission grant does not cover all of our operating costs, such as rent, utilities, phone, internet. So I'm trying to cover that with that other grant as well. We did receive $15,000 from the Glenn Foundation in July.
To be used for what?
And that is being called used right now for operating costs.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for what you do, certainly. And it's troubling to see that you're serving more children. We wish the opposite were true, but the fact that you're there and able to help these children is somewhat reassuring in that they are getting some of the help they need. Councilwoman Craig already asked a question that I had, but another one that I had was, this is a five-year commitment, correct?
That's what I'm asking for, yes.
Right. And just help me understand a few things in that this position that you're hiring for, there are already similar positions with social services with the county?
What we have in place right now are seven people who are trained as forensic interviewers. Three of them are full-time forensic investigators with the Department of Social Services. They have to juggle their schedules in order to be able to come to the CAC to do these interviews. Brandy Miller, who is one of those investigators, has done about 34% of the interviews that we've had at the CAC so far this year. One is a Gaston County police officer, Gaston County detective. Another one is a Gastonia City police officer or detective. Sherry Reinhart from the Lincoln County CAC will come down when we need her. And Emily Miller, who is their forensic interviewer from the Lincoln County CAC, also comes down when we need her. But we're juggling schedules, and we're not, it sometimes, you know, when people were on vacation or whenever they have other commitments and stuff, it's a struggle for us to be able to make sure that we're able to serve the police departments and DSS when they need us. So
I guess what I'm trying to understand, and I'm not questioning you this to
And we don't pay those people. I'm going to interrupt you, Todd. But
no, you're fine. And I'm not questioning the validity. I guess I'm trying to understand the structure in how your agency works and how DSS works and then how, you know, the police departments work that. So if there's a child that needs the advocacy services, is CAC providing a service that the Department of Social Services wouldn't provide? Is that what we're looking at?
We are providing, the CAC provides a facility that has the capability for the forensic interview, which is audio and videotaped, that is used as evidence in court. All of this is in preparation for court. What we also do is we make referrals for medical examinations and for mental health services. We all get together twice a month. We all sit down, anyone who was involved in the investigations, on the first and third Wednesday at 8 o'clock in the morning. We get together at the CAC and we review these cases. And what happens there is that we are able to come up with a more comprehensive plan for this family and a plan for making sure that this case does not fall through the cracks. That some of the folks that come together at that meeting have information that someone else doesn't have, or they can combine compare records and see, you know, exactly, okay, I know this about this family. We had a situation just recently where we found out that when we sat down that the victim child was going to a funeral of a family member. The police department did not know that, and the perpetrator was going to be there. We were able to stop that before it happened because of that type of, because of the meeting that we have and the case review that we have. DSS could pull that together, but what we do is we save them time, we save them money, we save them, you know, the expense of going out and trying to put the services together that we have put together. This system has been proven to be very effective all the way across the country. And that is why the CAC needs to be. And we are not a county-funded agency.
So the service you provide is more comprehensive. It's not just making sure that the child or the victim gets to court and has representation.
No.
It's more.
There's a whole lot more of that. It's a whole lot more complicated than that.
And a follow-up with that is, let's say that the court case or the criminal case, whatever the situation is concluded. Does the CAC have a program, or do they participate in a program? What happens to that child after that?
After court.
Everything's said and done. It's resolved. But obviously, that child is going to have more issues.
We stay in touch with families. We can't force families to do anything. We don't have that kind of authority. But DSS does, and the police do. But once that court system, that court process is over with, then the police step out. DSS, if they are involved, if they've taken custody, of course, you know, they have case managers. We work together with those case managers. We work together with the mental health counselors, and we make ourselves available to the families all through the prosecution process. And then afterwards as well, we'll call them, we follow up with them, we continue to follow up with the family until they tell us they don't need us anymore.
Again, thank you for the service you provide for the community, and thank you for answering my questions.
Ms. Craig, back to you.
I was going to ask, for sure, is CAC in Lincoln County, who funds them? Do they have any government funds?
Yes, they do.
They're a nonprofit.
They are the Lincoln County Coalition Against Child Abuse and the Child Advocacy Center. I think that's
who funds them up there?
Lincoln County. Lincoln County actually owns the property that their CAC is located on, and they pay them a very minimal amount for rent every year. They are a nonprofit. The town of Lincolnton also pays, I don't know how much, but they pay for their, not for their services so much, but they so help support them. They get a tremendous amount of support.
And in what respect does the city of Lincolnton help them?
I have been told that they give them financial support as well as, you know, helping them with their events and helping them fundraise and...
Like with in-kind services, you might say.
In-kind service, yes. But they do help them financially as well.
Oh, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Thank you for those answers, because it is complicated.
It's, yes.
It is a complicated structure. But you mentioned that Lincoln County, the word coalition, mm-hmm. they are in a coalition. And I'm wondering if there's other partners in the CAC other than, I mean, that requested partners, okay? I know you've requested from the county.
Mm-hmm.
You're requesting from the city. Are there any other coalition partners out there that could be approached to for financial help, like the hospital maybe?
The hospital is very supportive of us.
Financially?
Yes, they have been.
All right. This year? Because I don't have any numbers on that.
No, you don't.
Okay. Am I not supposed to?
No. Oh. It was anonymous.
Oh, okay. I don't have any other questions at this point.
Caremont is, I'm going back to Doug, and I'm also going back to Gene Matthews with the Cannon Belk Foundation. And I am planning on going and talking to the city of Belmont. I don't want to scare anybody when they're thinking, oh my God, she's coming towards me. But, you know, there are plenty of other partners here in the city and in the county that we can go to and say, you know, help us. We could go to the city of Cherville. We could go to any of the other 12, not the other, I guess it would be 11, jurisdictions that we have to deal with. Because we, you know, we get cases from Cramerton. We get cases from Cherville. We get cases from Stanley. We've gotten a few cases from Charlotte Mecklenburg, but they have involved Gaston County children. So, you know, there's a number of other places that we can go to, but like I said, I've been extremely busy. I haven't had time to get to them yet. So.
Dr. Grilly.
Dottie.
Yes.
I really respect you and what you do, and I really appreciate the fact that you are coming to us, because that must mean that you think we're pretty nice folks.
Yes, and I've known most of y'all for a long time.
We like to think we're pretty nice folks, too. And as you know, we're many, many hats. So I'm up here, and I'm hearing a really strong need, and you know, I just want to, you know, probably, you know, write you a check, but I'm having a more difficult time writing the city's check because of the fact that we have lots of needs in this community, and you know, the city could write checks to the Dream Center, we could write checks to Bit of Hope Ranch, we could write checks to hundreds of organizations. So
But do they help with the prosecution of sex offenders and people who abuse their kids?
No. But, you know, sometimes we have to go back and get a little bit more basic with this and strip it down to really, you know, a 501c3 is requesting monies from the city, and they are taxpayer dollars. and we represent the taxpayers, and we have to make decisions each time we meet and vote on the best way to spend those taxpayer dollars. Now, there are people that criticize thoughts of subsidizing adoption expenses at the county level, okay, which would be also considered a charitable type of event or activity. So there's lots of things, and yet, you know, I really think that at times Gastonia gets, you know, called upon to, you know, step forward, and we like to step forward. You know, we all like to do good things and support our community. But, you know, we have a bus system in the city that supports both the city and the county residents. You know, we have a Cats Express system that supports county residents that the city pays for, not the county pays for. This is truly a county-based activity, although there are many citizens in the city that are supported by this, but they're also all county taxpayers. So to ask us for $15,000 a year, to think that you're going to get $10,000 a year from the county, just seems lopsided even of itself.
I asked them originally for $15,000 a year.
You should ask them for $25,000.
Well, we were starting with 15.
I understand that. Okay. I understand that.
They had never supported the CAC like that before either. And I knew coming out like this and starting this at the, you know, our first year into this was going to be a gamble. But an average every month from the last year, 25% of the cases that we have assisted in have come from the Gastonia City Police. And $15,000 doesn't even cover a third of what this position would pay.
Now, we understand all that. We really do. But they are all county citizens.
Not all of them.
Well,
I'm sorry, the children are all county citizens, but there's a large number of them. If you've got 25% of our cases that are coming through the CAC that come from the Gastonia City Police, they have to be citizens of Gastonia.
But they're all county citizens.
They're all county citizens. Of course
right.
They are.
Yeah. So that's where I think we really want to support you as county citizens.
Mr. Kimball?
The other question I had, Ed, maybe you could help me out with this. You know, obviously, we just heard that there's a 25% generation ratio of our children here in the city of Gastonia. But yet, I'm also sensitive to what you just said, Doctor, about that they are county residents as well. And there are also a number of other 501c3 charities come before us. Ed, is this something, and maybe this is not something we can address right now, is this something that the Police Foundation could step forth or make a part of their fundraising and or civic generated funding?
I think we need to look into it, but I think that's a very possible revenue source. I mean, I think that's something that we should explore with the foundation. Need to be careful about what they can spend money for, mm-hmm. but certainly I think that's a really good idea and something that we should explore.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Okay. That's why I just looking both ways.
No, I like your idea, Councilman Kimball, and it goes along with what I was thinking too, because I haven't heard anybody say that this is a bad thing to support.
Right.
Certainly everybody thinks it's a good thing to support. There's some issues on spending city taxpayer dollar on a nonprofit. I get that. I understand that.
If any of you want to write a check, I'll take it.
I wish I could write you a check for the whole thing. I wish I could. But at the same time, I don't know that that means that the city would have to be out. The city could be the conduit for having those funds amassed, and there may be several different avenues we could pull from, the Police Foundation being one of those And I'm guessing, so there may be legalities or stipulations that prevent some of this, but like maybe even monies from forfeitures through criminal activity. And the city could kind of be the conduit for gathering those funds and saying, okay, well, here's your money each year, and it's from this source, and this source, but we could still be the conduit. Now, having said that, I'm not sure that's exactly what you're going to want tonight, because that means our city manager would have to look into these different things and see if legally we can funnel that money in that way. So I don't know if that... Would that make your objections more palatable if it were to happen that way and it's not actually tax dollars that the city's... We would almost be helping in a way to fundraise or to provide a contribution.
I think any source, you know, of funds other than, you know, again, tax, you know, dollars, I totally support. And I will write you a check.
I'll take it, David.
I'll write it to your organization. I won't write it to you.
I understand.
Is that something that you could look into, Mr. Munn, and find if we could? Because I think with the $15,000, it's $15,000 a year for 5 years, is what you're looking for.
For 5 years, that's what we're looking for.
So if we could look at these different sources and know that it's sustainable for 5 years, because we certainly don't want to put the CAC in a position where we say, well, we can do it for 5 years, and then one of those sources isn't available, and two, and they don't get their funding. So we need to make sure it's sustainable for 5 years and that those sources can be legally used for that. And if you could check on that and amass that or organize that, then I would feel good about it. And I'm sorry, I interrupted Ms. Craig.
No, you didn't. No, I didn't get started.
You're good. Start now.
I would like to make a motion.
Go right ahead.
Because I think that we have the desire. Every one of us sitting up here have the desire, and for the children and for the organization. It's a matter of the devil's in the details, okay?
Mm-hmm.
As Dr. Curlin taught me years ago. And so I would like to make the motion that we table this until the city manager has an opportunity, and I know we're tabling it for the second time, but I think there's still some more pieces of the puzzle that we need that we need to have before we make a final decision. But to table it and get information from some funding sources, and also see if there are other partners out there that can come to the table and look at this holistically, because, you know, we, like you said, Councilman Pearsall, we could maybe fund it for a year or two, and then we can't sustain it. So we need to make sure that this is a countywide collaboration for the betterment of the countywide children and their families. So that's my motion.
Could you add in the motion rather than just tabling it? And Mr. Munn, you tell me if this is enough time. Maybe at our next council meeting, could you find out about those funding sources so that we can put a date on when we'll bring this back up, rather than just say tabling it and it come up whenever?
We can give you a report at the next meeting. And also, I'd like to talk to the county manager and coordinate what we're doing with the county. We'll report back at the next council meeting.
Would that be all right to include the next council
sure.
meeting's date in the motion?
30 days.
Keep Dottie just hanging out there forever. We'll have a date when we've got the answers.
Yeah, okay. That's fine.
I don't know if I have all the answers,
right,
but we'll definitely have a report.
Hopefully. Most of them.
Right. Sir. Okay, is there...
And I'll second that
you
motion.
Second. Yes. I'm waiting. Okay, yes, sir. Is that what you were...
Are we going to move to discussion?
Discussion now, yes, sir.
Ed, would that include action from your office on contacting the supervisory personnel in the police foundation to see maybe we could share in total what was presented to us tonight via a recording and see if they, number one, would be interested, and number two, they would take on this organization as part of what they, an earmark, so to speak, that they would move forward each year. And when folks donate to the police foundation, they know a part of that is going to help children that need a voice.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I have, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, that's November 17th.
Mm. Just one thing, Mr. Mayor. Mm. Just one thing.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Dottie, there's a group for the county. Is it the multidisciplinary team?
Yes.
That is overseeing
that
your group?
Members of the multiple disciplinary team, they don't oversee us.
Okay.
My board oversees me.
Okay.
The multiple disciplinary team are the members of the police departments, all 12 police departments, including the sheriff's office. That is representatives from the hospital, mental health agencies, juvenile justice department. I'm going to forget somebody. Dr. Shawnee Singleton, who is the physician who does our medical examinations over at Caremont Pediatric Partners. I'm going to forget somebody. Who? Oh, I'm sorry. The assistant district attorneys. Debbie will get me. They are all the multiple disciplinary team. In other words, that is members of all of the disciplines who are involved in each child's case, whether it goes to court or not. Okay. And what the way this thing is structured, I'm the executive director. I have our prevention efforts here, and I have the CAC here. Mm-hmm. Most CACs across the country start with the forensic interviews, the medical examinations and stuff, and they are getting more into prevention. We kind of went at it backwards. We started with prevention, then we took over the CAC. The multiple disciplinary team is part of the CAC.
Okay. Because I would like to hear from them as well, because they're part of this. And Ed, I don't know if you could set it up where they can come in as well at our next meeting.
I saw Debbie in the hallway. She said she had talked to you about coming to talk to the city council.
Because I think it would be helpful for everyone on the council to hear it. Okay. Because you do good work, and it does help out a lot of the children, and you get a lot of people that have abused children behind bars, and that's the ultimate goal. Thank you.
I couldn't have one of y'all come during a child's interview, but anytime any of you want to come over to the CAC and see it and walk through it, you know, we can show you what we do.
And you're located where?
We are.
That's something that you don't.
Not
yeah.
Be given
okay.
Out.
Shouldn't. Thank you.
We have not.
Yes. Okay. We will call you.
We have not put the address out. When we get a new location, we will be advertising that location, but we are looking for a new location right now as well as this. So.
There's a motion and a second. There's no other questions or comments. All in favor of the motion, raise your hand, please. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. That's November the 17th.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. We're skipping the one at City Hall, November 3rd, which is
correct.
Okay, so do you want me to come back on November 17th?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. You asked me about the other grant, and I just remembered what it was. We were awarded a $14,000 grant for new audio-video equipment from the Southern Regional Children's Advocacy Center. We have not received those funds yet either, but they are coming.
Great.
And we are not putting that new equipment in our present location. We're waiting until we have the funds to get a new location.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dottie, very much. Item 6 is a new outdoor rental lighting option. Presentation, Mr. Michael Peoples, Director of Enterprise Services. This is exhibit number 6.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council, for the opportunity to discuss LED lighting with you tonight. Sitting here impressed by the scouts sitting so still. I don't think the ones that my 9-year-old run around with could do that. So kudos over there for you. I'd also like to thank Gary Lutz and Ron Gaff and Richard Myers, not here, but for their hard work on getting this plan together. As you're aware, the electric department's been working on implementation of LED lighting across the city, mainly in street lighting, Myrtle School Road, Franklin Boulevard, I think South New Hope has a few, and we'll continue with those opportunities as funding is available. But tonight, we want to focus on rental lighting. So one of the things that I was impressed about, there's over 7,000 rental lights in the system in the city of Gastonia. That equals over $1 million in revenues each year. So right now, we're using older technology, high-pressure sodium lights, sort of emitting that kind of color right there above you right now. And then the white lighting, which is metal halide and mercury vapor, which mercury vapors, since 2005, has been sort of placed on the side, no longer going to use mercury vapor, but metal halide is still in the system. But we have this new technology, LED lighting, that's been used. It's usually more expensive, or has been in the past, but it's becoming more and more affordable. So what we would like to do is begin converting over all of our lighting to LED lighting. Just a few facts about LED lighting. Energy consumption is approximately half, which means a lot to us because we are an electric city and we purchase wholesale power. Color rendering is more like natural light, just white lighting like we talked about. And glare is almost non-existent. Upward light pollution is reduced. And usually the manufacturers are warranting these for over 10 years, which means less maintenance for us and rolling out crews. So what we're looking at, and in your materials, there's probably about 4 pages. We're going to have not only the memo, but then the proposed rate structure for these lights. What we're recommending for you tonight is to move forward in this conversion without any kind of cost increases. So we would begin implementing LED technology throughout the city at no additional cost to those that are already renting lights. One example, and we use this because it's the one that's most widely known and used, is what we have currently in your backyard. Say your backyard security light is a 100-watt high-pressure sodium light. We're looking at replacing that with a 50-watt LED light at the same cost. But the rate of return is greater for the LED, even though the fixture costs a little bit more up front. And we capture that by energy savings, even at the wholesale rate at approximately 9 cents kilowatt hour. So this is something that we can do at no additional cost to the customers. The rate of return is quicker than high-pressure sodium. And really, it's going to be what all systems, all electric systems, and we've met with Duke Energy. They're moving to this as well as Rutherford. So most systems are moving towards LED lights because now they are more affordable. We would like to implement this by December 1st and working with our billing folks. And another offering that we're prepared to do is have sample lighting installed at the Municipal Operations Center so that folks can come down, see what the lights look like, the decorative lights as well, and make their decisions before they call Richard and go ahead and order the new light. I'll be happy to answer any questions of all the materials.
Bishop.
Michael, thank you for the information provided in our packet. I certainly read over that. And from what it looked like to me, obviously what you explained as far as the new cost, and it looks like in about 5 years all this will be paid for, basically.
Yes, sir.
So after the 5 years, we're looking at significant savings that we are incurring on these lights. It's actually a revenue generator for the city, more or less, in an even larger capacity than it is now, because the cost of operating these lights is less, but the current rate that will be paid is the same. Am I understanding that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And like I said, I appreciate all the information you provided in the packet, and I'm sure there's some more discussion, but I'll just go ahead and throw it on the table that I make the motion to approve.
Second. A discussion, Ms. Craig.
I would just say that the LED lights are becoming much more affordable across the board, because 2 years, 3 years ago, when LEDs were coming on board and in the sign business, we were beginning to use them, okay? But now they have really dropped in price because they're so effective and efficient that they, you know, everybody's converting over to them, even not only, like I said, not only in municipalities probably, but in the private sector too, where they're being used. So I'm glad to see us looking into that, and as having a security light in our backyard, I can go for that. That'd be great.
Mr. Campbell.
Thank you, Your Honor. Michael, I believe it was probably late spring, and we had discussed a case study that really bears out a lot of what you're indicating tonight. Many auto dealers are actually now going to the LED lights. They were one of the first groups, and I was fortunate to read a case study that was done specifically in different, actually a dealer group in different parts of the, locations in different parts of the state. And again, off the cuff, I think it was a little over a year they were able to pay for what their conversion costs were. And you make a great point also, the man hours of not replacing bulbs. Now, in particularly with the auto dealers, that means moving cars so you can get to the light to move your boom truck in to replace it. So I think it's real good technology. The other thing that came from that study, and I shared it with, I believe it was Christy, it's a brighter light, if you will, and it provides better illumination capabilities than what we're using now. So I think this is a plus and a plus. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Michael, the lighting that you have in here on page 6-5, the decorative lighting for outdoor rental, is that online at all? Because I know my wife loves to shop online and then go down and see it. So
it certainly will be. We wanted to present the materials for you tonight and implement the program December 1st, but absolutely prepared to have these materials online and available.
Excellent. Thank you.
Any other? Motion second. Then we have. Any other discussion at all? All in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Jim? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you a lot, Mike. Item 7 is a renewal of water and sewer utility agreement between the City of Gastonia and the Town of Randolph. Presentation, Mr. Matt Bernhardt, Director of Public Works and Utilities. Excuse me just a second.
Yes, sir.
Gentlemen, come back to see us. Mr. Reed, thank you. Go right ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Good evening, Mayor and members of the council. It's a pleasure to bring you a very positive agenda item, which is the renewal of a partnership between the City of Gastonia and the Town of Randolph. Gastonia has a bulk service agreement with the Town of Randolph to provide water and wastewater service, and that was a 20-year agreement that is set to expire next year. I think it's a very positive thing that the Town of Randolph actually initiated the discussion and requested renewal of the contract. It's been a very, very positive and effective relationship for both entities. When they've had to call on us for emergency assistance, they've had a problem, we've come running. We work together very well, it was a very positive discussion between Randolph staff and city staff. There was really only one major change, which was slightly increasing the amount of the maximum capacity limit of the sewer. Randolph is the second largest water user, second largest water customer, and the fourth largest wastewater customer for Gastonia. So they are significant to us. The agreement that you have in your packet was drawn up by our city legal staff, reviewed by Randolph's legal counsel, and has been unanimously approved by the Randolph board. So we present it to you with a recommendation for its approval, and if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Questions of Mr. Bernhardt? Anyone?
I'll make the motion to approve.
Second.
Second here, sir.
Discussion. All in favor?
You had discussion down here.
Discussion.
I just want to clarify. This is a 25-year lease as opposed to a 20-year lease.
Yes, ma'am.
Right.
We did discuss with Ranlow, and I do apologize. The term of the new agreement would be 25 years rather than 20, and that was something that Ranlow felt was a positive also.
Great.
Yes.
Matt, does Ranlow have any problems within the sewer pipes or anything of that nature that you see on the horizon that's going to be a big expenditure?
Every utility system has capital projects and capital needs. We are currently working with Ranlow on a project in the Smyre community. That is actually an area that is within the city limits of Gastonia, but is served by a water system connected to Ranlow's system. And it's a system that is somewhat dilapidated and failing. And at Ranlow's request, we are working with them to convert the customers in that area over to our system so that Ranlow can close out that dilapidated system and eliminate it. It's a $400,000 project, so we're doing it in phases, and the first phase is in planning right now. It will eliminate about 3,000 feet of line and move over about 20 customers. There are about 120 customers total that would be affected. And again, it's a good partnership. We're working with Ranlow because it has to be done, you know, carefully, killing off old lines as people are connected over to our system. So that's in the works right now.
Thanks, Matt.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions? All in favor? Okay, thank you. Sure. Thank you, Matt. It's unanimous. Gina? item 8 is a resolution designating Detective Adam Wilson as the official of the City of Gastonia concerning making recommendations to the ABC Commission concerning the ABC permits. Our presentation is Mr. Robert Helton, Gastonia Police Chief.
Mayor, Council, in your packet, Exhibit A2 is a resolution designating Detective Adam Wilson as the official of the City of Gastonia concerning making ABC recommendations to the ABC Commission. What I wanted to do tonight, in addition to presenting that, is to just recognize Adam and put a face with a name. He's going to be our new ABC officer. He's going to replace Aaron Worcester. Adam started out with the Dallas Police Department, was there for a few years before he came to us. But when he came to us in 09, he came to us as a hard charger. Was a hard worker right off the bat, worked on patrol, very quickly became a gang liaison officer, and then after just a couple of years, because of his hard work and his initiative, moved to be a street crimes officer, and he served in that capacity for the last 5 years. We had a very thorough process looking for a new ABC officer, and he came through that with shining colors. He did very well, and in addition to just preparing for that opportunity, he also took some classes on his own and went online and took some classes just preparing for that interview and to be really ready for it and really shined when he came through that and did very well in the process. And so we're recommending Adam Wilson be our new ABC officer moving forward. And I would be remiss, and I'll give you an opportunity here to make comment or questions in just a moment. I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize also Aaron Worcester, who has served as our ABC officer, where Aaron, if you'll step up, for the past 5 years. And he has done a tremendous job, not only with enforcement and making sure that folks are doing what they're supposed to be doing with ABC permits and making recommendations to the council or to the commission, but also being really a mentor to businesses about what they need to do, what they should do, or if there's problems to give them some guidance about how they need to correct to make sure they're in compliance with the ABC law. So he's done a tremendous job, and I want to recognize him also for the job he's done over the past 5 years. Aaron was just recently promoted to sergeant, and that's why he's moving out of this position. He has graciously agreed to continue to be a backup for Adam. If Adam's out of town or something happens and we need a permit signed or something with a permit, he's also going to be available to help with that as he moves forward. But his promotion, Aaron's promotion ceremony is actually Thursday at 3 o'clock, and you all are invited if you'd like to come down and be a part of that. We're actually swearing in 10 new officers and promoting 2 sergeants, and Aaron's going to be one of the sergeants promoted. But we would like for you to give recognition to Adam Wilson as new ABC officer.
Yes, sir.
We certainly want to say welcome to Adam. And my comment was just on Mr. Worcester and being involved with a lot of the events downtown. I just want to say thank you. I don't know where you get your patience. I really don't. This gentleman not only enforces the law and the ordinances and things, but he really does go that extra step to help educate so that you don't make the same mistakes twice, so that you know what you're doing going in. And like I said, I don't know where you get your patience, but I've seen it firsthand. And thank you for all that you've done for all the wonderful events downtown and throughout the city and county. And we certainly look forward to working with Mr. Wilson in the future.
Yes, sir. Mr. Kimball.
Thank you, Your Honor. Thank you, Chief Helton. I, on behalf of the ABC board, the other part of your job, Sergeant Worcester, that can't go really unnoticed is your accessibility. And I don't know how many times different business owners or board members have said and commented how quickly you call someone back and in layman's terms, they can never stump you with a question. You always have the information right off the bat, and you return phone calls, and you are nurturing to many of the businesses, as you indicated, Councilman Pearsall, that folks that do want to do the right thing, and they're not exactly sure what the regulations are, and frankly, sometimes they can be onerous and confusing. And I know there's been many times that folks have said, hey, broke that down for me. I have a better understanding of what I need to do, and I'm going to do it to stay in compliance. So I think you have sort of some big shoes to fill. from what the chief said, I think that I think you can fill them, and you're going to be a backup to him when he needs a hand. So I think that's a good thing. So thank you very much for coming aboard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'll make the motion that we pass this resolution as presented by Chief Helton.
I will second.
Any other discussion? All in favor of this resolution? Opposed? Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. You know, Mr. Kimball, with all respect to what you said about Ms. Forster and about the sergeant, I don't think you'd be in your right mind if you argued with him his size anyway. I mean, he's as big as he is. I just, whatever he says is fine.
Sometimes you want to bring that to the table.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jim. Thank you, Adam. Item 8 is the item 9 is the Facilities Management Committee meeting report presentation. Mayor Pro Tem Brenda B. Craig, Chairman. That's the number 9.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The Facility Management Committee committee met on Wednesday, October the 7th at 5:30. And we had just a couple of items that were on the agenda. Item number 1 was offered to purchase 336 Vance Street by Preservation North Carolina. The city had received an offer from Preservation North Carolina to purchase a city-owned lot at 336 South Vance property at Vance Street in the amount of $6,000. This property is located in the Luray Mill Village National Register Historical District, Luray District. Preservation North Carolina currently owns another house in the Luray District, which must be removed from its current location. Since the house is a contributing structure to the Luray District historical status, Preservation North Carolina would like to move the house to 336 South Vance Street. This will allow the house to remain in the Luray District as a contributing structure, and it can be renovated to increase and improve the availability of housing in the district. So the committee listened to the reasoning why. The staff recommended that the property on 336 South Vance Street be sold at private sale to Preservation North Carolina for the sum of $6,000, subject to restrictions in the resolution. Now, this does not go up for upset bid. Is that right, Mr. Smith?
the resolution has to be published one time, and the notice time has to run 10 days before you can close. So no upset bid.
Okay. That's where we are. The recommendation, and I put it in the form of a motion, that the committee voted unanimously 3-0 to approve the resolution to accept the offer from Preservation North Carolina to purchase a vacant city-owned lot located at 336 South Vance Street for $6,000.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor of the motion, please.
Thank you.
Opposed? Thank you.
Uh-huh. The next item was just an update on the Gastonia Conference Center. Mr. Michael Nolan, Culinaire, provided the committee with an update on the Gastonia Conference Center transition process. Mr. Nolan stated that the process is going smoothly and staff has been instrumental in assisting with this transition. At this time, the profit and loss statements are not available. However, they will be provided at the next committee meeting, and we will be anxiously waiting for those profit and loss statements. And I think someone's here from Culinaire, that if any council members would like to ask any questions regarding the transition.
Any questions? Yes. Hmm? Got a question for the Culinaire.
Mr. Nolan is here.
Yeah, there
he is. Okay.
If he'd like to come to the
Could
podium.
Could you come to the podium, Mr.
Just
Nolan?
Just say hi and put a face on right. Culinaire. And,
How you doing? Thank you, Council. I'm Michael Nolan. This is Noel Murphy with Culinaire.
I think we met most of you before.
Yep.
Good to see you.
So I've got one question. Are there any available times this this holiday season to book any parties at the conference center?
We're currently having, well, just to let you in, Lauren Braxton, we did retain her as the sales manager for the conference center. We're also having, we hired a gentleman named Jerry Durkee. He's a local Gastonian, so he's going to be the director of sales. Currently, they are going through all the Fridays and Saturdays and trying to rebook everything we had from last year. So as of this afternoon, only one group has turned down not repeating their Christmas party. So just budget cuts. So hopefully by rebooking them and securing other business.
You want that?
Well, yeah, I just, you know, when the committee met with Mr. Nolan, Mr. Nolan said, you know, looked like, you know, the season might be a little soft, and so I thought if we could get him up here and promote that, that wouldn't be a bad thing. And then I wanted to follow up with one other question, which was, you know, you remarked at the committee meeting, speaking about a sales blitz. Can you explain to the council and mayor a little bit more about what that is?
Yeah, the sales blitz, we're currently looking to either the middle of November or the first week of December. Basically, we would bring in our vice president of sales and marketing, David Wood, who was present in the initial presentation to the council. But so himself, along with our salespeople, Jerry, Lauren, and then some regional people with Culinaire, would come in a war room type atmosphere where they all sit down, look over all the past business we've had for, you know, everything on the books for the last 5 years, give everybody a call and see where they're at, see why they haven't rebooked, see if there's new contacts, and ultimately leading to a get-together of sorts at the conference center where we invite them all down, you know, bring a friend, bring coworkers, come and see what we can do one evening, and then hopefully from there generate future business.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir. Michael, just want to say publicly thank you for helping out for the Electric Power Week where you guys had served food and catered it for us. It was really nice. It was down at East Ridge Mall, and the food was excellent. I appreciate it.
Great. Thank you. Yes, it was nice to be involved with the community.
He picked us a good hot dog.
Thank you. He had two.
Let me
Ether.
A statement and a question, please, very quickly. The statement is that I've talked to a lot of people that since this is change has taken place, and it's primarily the Rotary clubs and so on, that they are very complimentary, extremely, with the staff and with the food and the quality, as you said, and the quality of the food. How do y'all feel? Are y'all pleased so far?
Very pleased. I mean, obviously, with just, you know, 1 month under our belt and kind of finishing up a profit and loss statement, the transition has been smooth. Christy with the city has been, you know, instrumental in helping us out. Vernon with the city has helped us a great deal. And just kind of learning the way, you know, everything operates and just getting our feet wet and hopefully moving this forward to, you know, a great partnership with the city and, you know, having a great venue to have events.
Well, thank we you. Were glad.
Dr. Gerlin, that's great.
Michael, could you take a minute, because there's a lot of people, we hope, or a lot of people watching, you know, tonight, or maybe watching the reruns in the next coming days. But, you know, we made a bold move in switching our management, and, you know, this is, you guys are number three, okay, in, you know, 3 to 4 years of existence of the Conference Center, and there's been a lot of, you know, a lot of criticism about that, and you know, some people who I don't believe are very well informed think that, you know, we're not doing a very good job, you know, in this realm. But if you could tell us, you know, tell the people in the audience here and those that may be watching a little bit more about what Culinaire is as a national organization, some of the existing sites that you all serve throughout the country, a little bit of background, just, you know, 3 minutes, you know, but just, you know, we want people to understand, you know, the breadth of your organization, the depth of your organization, the professional depth of your organization, and why, you know, we picked you. And I want you guys to brag for a minute.
Sure. Well, we are based in Dallas, but Dallas, Texas.
Is so, that where your accent's from?
It is. East
Dallas. I thought so.
But we have roots here. We're in Charlotte. We're now in Gastonia. And our company structure allows us to do a lot of things in-house. A lot of things were outsourced before. We're bringing those back in. We want to control them, the quality, the offerings. And our structure in Dallas allows us a lot to be done without a real cost. So that management fee covers that. We're 1 month into this. We've got still a few things trickling in. That's why we're trying to finalize that agreement, the P&L. But it's looking promising for a first month, and we've got some good momentum we think that will carry us through into the you know, next part of the year. Our background, we're nationally zoos, convention centers, airports. We're in everything, and we have a lot of experience. We have a lot of resources and a lot of people we can call on to bring them in. So in a nutshell, that's us.
Thank you.
I just wanted to thank you for keeping Lauren on, because she is such an asset for the organization, and I'm glad that y'all saw the same thing in her that we saw in her. So thank you for that.
She knows everybody.
She does. She does. Yes, sir. You're exactly right. And that's my report.
That is your report. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, that's that was just on the other matters. We're through with that one. Item 10 is the Public Safety Committee meeting report, Councilman Gallagher. It's item 10, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Wednesday, October 12th at 5:30, we had our Public Safety Committee meeting. Mayor Pro Temp Brenda Craig was there and Councilman Todd Pearsall. We discussed the 800 megahertz system. Staff presented, really Todd Carpenter, presented information to the committee on consolidation of the public safety system. An interlocal agreement, governmental agreement, was established with Gaston County and the city of Gastonia back in 1998. In 2012, the agreement was renewed for 10 years, and the components of the system were discussed, including network core, radio core, application core, mobile computing, internet, and email, computer peripherals, desk software support, and perpetuation of dispatch services, and costs which were shared by all the participating agencies. Also, the committee discussed the 800 megahertz system. Gastonia Police and Fire have the 800 megahertz system for several years now, and they are very pleased with the system. However, Gaston County does not, and Gaston County has to make a decision pretty soon on this. From what I understand, their system's getting antiquated, and they're going to have to figure out what they're going to do. And I believe we're having communications with them and they're going to be making a decision shortly. Mayor Pro Tem Craig requested to go on records that Gaston County needs to provide the 800 megahertz communications, which would allow to make communications between the county and the city more consistent and efficient. Recently, we were discussing with Chief Helton regarding there was a chase coming from Charlotte into Gaston County, and there was a chopper overhead, and he was watching the car, and our squad car has numbers on top of them, and they're able to directly correspond because of the 800 megahertz system that we have with the police police officers in our vehicles. The county police, they would have to do some type of patch or so or go through the 911 system in order to communicate. But the police were able to communicate with that chopper, and the chase, you know, ensued, and the bad guys got out and they left the car, but the chopper was overhead and was able to speak to our guys, so we were able to apprehend the desperados. So kudos to the 800 megahertz system. The committee advised staff to be mindful that the budget session for the next fiscal year will be held in the upcoming months, and that staff needs to be aware of any communication technology equipment that may be replaced, refreshed, such as radios. Chief Welsh stated that they're very pleased with the current Motorola radio system that the fire department's using. Ash had stated that the consolidated communication system is complicated. Gaston County operates a dispatch system. The city oversees the computer support. Now this is the part that it is noted that the city's public safety answering point, PSAP, by virtue of interlocal, was turned over to the county, which means, and this is the big kicker, all 911 service funds are distributed to the county only. We, the city, do not get those funds. So that's just something to keep in the back of your mind when we're speaking with the county. That information was just presented to the council just for informational purposes. Item two, we discussed the hiring practices with the fire department and the police department. Chief Welsh provided information on the recruitment and hiring practices of Gastonia Fire Department. Chief Welsh stated that the fire department had recruited a recruitment task force that goes to colleges, university, job fairs, and other events for recruitment and purposes. However, the most of the candidates are obtained from the city's online website and by word of mouth. Plus, they have this card that they have that they give out when they see somebody in and about the city. And if Chief Welsh sees them, or one of the top commanders sees somebody that, you know, they feel is going to be a worthy firefighter, they will present them with this card, and they'll sign their names on the bottom, and they'll ask them to apply, which is really neat. However, most candidates are obtained from the city's online website and by word of mouth. Before the candidate can be considered for position, they must pass four tests: career readiness certification, candidate physical agility test, a panel interview, and the chief's interview at the end. All of these requirements are provided in detail on the city's website. So if you want to see what the tests are all about, you go right there and you can see them. After the meeting, all requirements, a hiring list is compiled, and it's usually set forth in June. So coming up is when I think it's going to start all up in January. So if you're really interested, get your name out there and see what you can do to become one of our firefighters. The other thing that we had discussed is Chief Welsh has set up an item with Hunter Huss, where they have some junior firefighters, kids that are interested in high school that want to become firemen. So they have some of our guys go down there and talk to them and help them and let them know what college classes they could take in order to become firefighters. And I have to commend the chief on that. That's an excellent job. Thank you. Then we also spoke to the police chief, Rob Helton, providing information on recruitment and hiring practices for the Gaston Police Department. Chief Helton stated that the police department has recruiters who visit colleges, universities, and attend committee meetings and recruitment purposes. Most of the candidates are obtained from the city website and word of mouth. Usually the hiring process takes 4 to 6 weeks. The candidate goes to post review board and is interviewed by the police chief. After the candidate is hired, they attend basic law enforcement training for 16 weeks and PTO training for 14 weeks. Chief Helton advised that the process seems lengthy. However, it is a necessary process. This is a time when the parties can evaluate each other. Currently, there are 12 vacancies in the police department. We have 146 officers on the street. 6 candidates finish rookie school this December 2nd, 2015, and they begin their PTO process with the expected release date by April of 2016. I also asked the chief, do you need a four-year degree to be a police officer? And he said that basically, Jim, you just need a two-year degree. But we encourage the officers to go back to school and get their four-year degree, which is nice. It'll help them out further, you know, down the road. Chief Helton also stated on this Friday, October 23rd at 9 o'clock, the police department's going to conduct a House of Worship safety and security seminar at Gaston First Assembly on Myrtle School Road. Any churches out there that want to know how to keep their pastors safe and congregation safe, because times such as this, you never know when someone's just going to go off. It's sad, but true. The police will be able to inform you. It's going to go from, I think from, what did I have down here? From 8 until noon, is that it, Chief?
It's actually from
9 to 12. So it's going to go from 9 to 12, and it's at First Assembly on Myrtle School Road this Friday. Plus, the police officers are going to have what they call Shop with a Cop, and it will be coming soon on November 3rd. The city of Gastonia will also hold canine trials at the Gaston Municipal Airport. So if you're down there, you can go see what they're doing with the doggies. And the last thing.
Just a question, actually a comment on item number two with regard to a recruitment. I guess it was about 6 months ago, I commented and I believe I gave you a copy of Pride magazine. That's the really the quintessential magazine for the African American community in the greater Charlotte area. And I took note that the Charlotte-Mecklenburg Police Department had advertisements in there seeking police officers. And I had made a request that we do the same in an effort to possibly diversify our police department to a greater degree. And recently, several months ago, the United States Conference of Mayors and the International Association of Chiefs of Police came together and they released a report, really in the aftermath of what happened in Ferguson, in Baltimore, strengthening police community relations in America's cities. And in fact, there's a number of great recommendations in here, but in particular, in the area of officer recruitment, they again really underscored the need to use non-traditional means and hiring practices to ensure that candidates are reflective of the community that they serve. So I think that there's a lot of, this is not just on recruitment, there's a lot of other issues in here that both the mayors and the police chiefs cooperatively came to an agreement on. And just where are we with the Pride magazine thing? I know that I thought we were going to move forward with that.
Right. We've discussed it, and I think when we had that conversation, we talked about having the advertisements for the winter months, mm-hmm. because there's a distribution that goes to some of the northern states, and I think the idea of coming to work in our community that has good weather was discussed, and so we're shooting for those.
Fantastic. Thank you, sir. That's all I have, sir. Thank you.
Sure. Walter, thank you. I do know that the Chief Police Helton, they go out to, this is something that's non-traditional, they go out to the CIAA tournament in Charlotte, and they'll try to recruit there. They also go to Johnson Wales, from what I understand. And the other thing they have is with the police, they have a junior police group, is it, Chief? Is that it? Am I saying that right?
Explorers.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Explorer program.
Go ahead.
The police Explorer program. From what I understand, we've had several of the officers that are officers now within the police department that are on it. Is that true?
Yeah, the Explorer program is actually a branch off of the Scout program, and it's for young people, I believe, age 14 to 18. And they come through and they help out with special events and events where they can, like downtown events, things like that, and they participate and they wear a uniform. And they actually have ranks within that. But it kind of gives them an idea of what our job is and gives them a little bit of exposure to see if that would be an interest later on. We have a number of officers that have went through the Explorer program and went on to be police officers, one of which is our Assistant Chief, Travis Britton. I remember back when he was just a young person, he's not here tonight to be mad at me talking about this, but was one of the majors in the Explorer program before he started with the police department. And now he's went on and moved through the ranks with the police department as well. So it has produced a number of officers for us, yes.
How would someone contact you in order to become one of the Explorers?
They could go online and look on our online site to go through that way, or just contact the police department at the front desk, 866-6702. We could put them in touch with the right people to get them started.
Excellent, Chief. Thank you. Appreciate it. Last item. That was for informational purposes as well. The last item, Mayor Pro Tem Craig inquired as the status of the market survey for the fire department, pay rates. Mr. Larry Wood informed the committee that the Human Resources has been conducting the surveys and the staff will provide recommendations at the next committee meeting. The committee requested that the meeting be held 4 weeks or 5 weeks at that time for staff to provide the report on the proposed market adjustment for the fire department. And that is my report, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir.
Good report. Do we need a motion?
Okay. Item 11, the city attorney.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Mayor, no formal report, but I certainly want to add my best wishes to Jenny Creighton and thank her for all she's done.
Absolutely. She likes it back there, I think.
She likes it, but she don't want me to say anything else. She's giving me the Danny crew. I'm going to chop your head off.
Yeah, motion. Right.
Yeah, okay. Take one and pass it down.
City manager's report, please.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, I also would like to thank Jenny for all the years. We're going to, of course, have a little get-together on Thursday, and we'll talk a little bit more. But she has meant so much to the city and so much to me, and we really appreciate all of her hard work, and we will miss her. Second, I would like to say that I thought that program that Electric put on at East Ridge Mall was really top-notch, and appreciated the support from the Conference Center, and we will plan to do that again. I think that it was very educational. The way that the dangers of electricity, when you're digging in your backyard, you don't actually have to hit the line, you just have to get close to it. And also there was this really interesting view of what happens when a squirrel gets into the substation. And you can see it all explode rather quickly. And so I thought it was done very well, and it's Public Power Week, and we're very proud of our electric department, and it was good to see that. I passed out to everyone, and I think I sent a memo to the council as soon as this happened, because it doesn't happen very often, that the city of Gastonia had two bond upgrades. We're going out to sell our water and bonds for our water plant, and both Fitch and Moody's increased our ratings. And we haven't had an increase in our rating, bond rating, in years. It's been, Melody and I were trying to remember how far back it goes, but it's been a long time, because a lot of what the bond rating agencies looked at was the decline of the textile industry. And so they marked that against us. But two of the three agencies actually increased our bond rating. And so that's quite a commitment for these outside agencies from New York City, taking a look at what we do here and saying you're credit worthy and you're doing a good job. On the second page of what I passed out, there's an estimate about what an increased bond rating means to us in dollars and cents. For instance, the $22 million bond issue that we have, that will lower the debt service by $140,000. So that's good news. And so you always, as an organization, as a city, as a state, you want to have as high a bond rating as you possibly can. So again, good news for the city of Gastonia and for the ratepayers of the city of Gastonia. Next, this is a picture of a bus shelter, a new bus shelter just installed and down at Bradford Heights. And so we're pleased to have that done. Each year, the city looks at various locations in the city and tries to build bus shelters. We work with our partner, the federal government, and they help pay for those. And so that's just another one. I think it's a really good design, and you'll see that is now in place. And the last thing is Mayor Bridgman and I got a letter from a gentleman named Richard Hancock. And Richard Hancock sent us a letter on October 12th. He is the project development and environmental analysis manager, and he's telling us that they're going to go forward to widen I-85, and they're going to go from Mecklenburg County, and in their sketch, in their drawing, they'll go a little past US 321. They'll actually go to Fairview in terms of the study area. And we really have encouraged them to do that, we want them to go to 74, because we don't want the Belmont pinch to become the Gastonia pinch. But what they're saying here is that they're going to begin their engineering studies now, and they are asking for any input that we might have by November 27th. This is just very early, and I think we're going to have a lot of input. They'll have public meetings and hearings. But I would say to the City Council, if you have questions or you just shoot them to us, we will then send them to the state at the very beginning. There is a companion project to the widening. The widening project would be four lanes in each direction. But there's also, they want to have intelligent transportation planning all the way through, so that the signage will tell us what's going on in terms of traffic conditions. And that will be from here in Gastonia, from 321, and moving forward east all the way to Sam Wilson Road in Mecklenburg County. Now, they say that the right-of-way funding is for 2022 and 2023, and also that construction funding is for 2024 and 2025. Now, these projects will tend to slip over time, too. So those, just as because we were supposed to have the intersection of 321 done in 2015. And so it is common that these projects slip, but here's the schedule, and you can see those dates out there, and this is what the state is notifying us in terms of widening I-85.
The information they're requesting, or as far as what you're saying, you'd like feedback from the council, that's just on that first part with the environmental study.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't want you to get inundated with every idea everybody has about everything about 85, because they're putting a timetable on the first section, which is the environmental study.
Although, I would say that if you have any idea,
bring it forward.
Bring it, and bring it early. Because what happens is, once these projects get some life to them, then they'll say, oh, that's outside the boundary area. Oh, I'm sorry, we've already done the review. We will have to stop and start all over again. For instance, I think there was a discussion about whether or not we wanted to put an interchange at Fairview. You know, and whatever, if there is something that concerns you, for instance, one of the things the state is looking at are those, whenever you enter the interstate, there would be a light that would only allow so much traffic on the interstate. You want to be very careful when you design the interstate that you have enough of a run, because you've come from a dead stop. Those of us that have gone to places like Los Angeles and seen those, you do need to make sure you have enough ramp room. But whatever the interest or question is, it could just simply be a question, I think we should participate. This is, you know, our main street is Franklin. You know, we always say that. But I-85, I mean, that's the economic driver that runs through our city. So, you know, what is done there and the specifics of it, it's very important to Gastonia.
Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
Ed, just something to bring up that was somewhat in the past, but we dealt with one of the integral issues of the I-85 widening. And if you recall, I believe we're at the transportation meeting, Representative Baumgartner was there about a subcomponent project was the widening of I-85 north to Cox Road exit. That was something that, you know, hopefully would be integrated into that. And we actually walked the area, and it's really a no-brainer for that. The room is really there, and it's something that would alleviate a lot of the holiday traffic and, frankly, some of the rear-end collisions that we're seeing on I-85 north. When traffic comes to a dead halt on I-85 north, while other folks from North New Hope are attempting to accelerate onto the highway and traffic stops. So that would give us a second dedicated lane to go off of there, and it really that needs to be with that right away.
Yeah, the second dedicated lane is a project that will be constructed before that, and that's okay. Actually will move quicker.
Great.
I know we looked at the possibility of a slip lane actually into the mall itself.
Correct.
But I don't know that they've approved that.
Okay.
But,
great.
Whenever this council sees the recommendations on that Cox Road study too, the Transportation Committee is going to be meeting later, and that'll report up to the City Council. There are some ideas there about different ways that the widening project and how we can deal with the traffic on Cox Road can be dealt with.
Thank you.
Ed, you know, just a few minutes after I got that letter from the state, of course, some of us are a little older than others. That's 8 or 10 years, like you said, they slip away sometimes. And all of us have seen that, if done the right way, pushing and the need versus the other needs, such as bypasses and so on, that we've heard over the years. We know how it works. But just a short time after getting that letter, I got on 85 and went to Belmont. And they were parked, and this was at 4 in the afternoon,
yeah,
going south. I'm talking about it about the Belmont-Mount Holly exit. They were just basically parked. It was a parking lot. But both directions, but primarily going south. And, you know, not a day goes by that somebody doesn't say there's got to be another bridge across the Catawba River. Now, they didn't say Garden Parkway. They said a bridge across the Catawba River. Saw in the news where the Charlotte City Council was going to have to vote on a whole new complex south of the airport in Steel Creek area. Plus, they're building another huge area, industrial building down there. Fast forward on over to South Point Road in Belmont, they're bumper to bumper. And now they're going to build more. And so I think DOT has realized something's got to give. There's got to be something across that river for Gaston County.
Yeah, the MPO project called Catawba Crossings actually crosses the Catawba River and the South Fork River and would take the road from Charlotte to New Hope Road. And that corridor is critically important to be able to get to the intermodal facility, uh-huh, and the airport. Mm-hmm. That is the economic engine. This coming Friday, we're going to have a groundbreaking at 1:30 at the Tech Park for another facility there, and a Brazilian company building that. Most of the companies that are locating there are European companies, and they're there because of the interstate and the connectivity to the Greenville-Spartanburg area. And as much connection that we can make to that economic engine to the east, to Charlotte, helps our people have jobs.
That's right.
And it's very important to our economic development. Correct?
Right.
Ed, I would... wanting to mention one thing, you know, it would be fascinating with this widening project for the state to look at opportunities to build park and ride lots,
yep,
along 85 because if you can marry more public transportation with a road widening, especially in areas where, you know, these might be parcels of land that may not be suitable for other purposes, but, you know, there are other parts of the country that will put these park and ride lots in right off of the interstate, which are basically only being served by people who, and they put parking garages there too, you know, and then, you know, those buses, they whip in and they whip out, you know, and for, you know, future needs, if we don't do more with public transportation as we're trying to increase capacity for, you know, automobiles, we're just never going to win. So, but I think that's something that should be explored heavily throughout this strip of widening.
Absolutely. Okay, sir. What else?
And that's all.
That's it. Thank you, sir. Okay, City Council report. Mrs. Craig.
Well, it's not working. It's dead.
That's better. I would just personally like to thank Miss Jenny also. With me and Colin when I first got on the council, and I'd say, Jenny, what am I supposed to do? And she says, Linda. And she was so sweet and so kind and so forgiving. So thank you for everything that you've done, Jenny, for all of us, but especially for me. I really, really appreciate it. And your happy days are ahead of you now. So have fun. And the next thing I wanted to say is that this coming Saturday, October the 24th, Sidney Craig and I will be married 56 years. Wow. This is our anniversary weekend. And so, Sidney, I wish you happy anniversary. I love you. That's my report.
Okay.
I also want to say thank you, Jenny. You sure helped me a lot over the years. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. Back in between 97 and 99 and since 2011. You've done great. And, of course, you're going to stay in touch with us, I'm sure. You're not going to just be gone and vanish out into the...
Not if she's smart.
Well, that's right. Mr. Peoples, thank you for the great program you had out at East Ridge. That was really great. I enjoyed it. But learned a lot. Didn't realize we had all that equipment. Nice equipment. Super good. Thank you. And that's my report.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor. Certainly, I'm not going to walk out without saying thank you to Jenny Creighton too. Brenda, I think you hit the nail on the head when you're a new council member and having to get in the rhythm of things with schedules and agendas and meetings, and Jenny's the one you call. I've never heard, it's not my job, I don't know. It's always, I'll get it, I'll do it, I'll find out. And I don't think I would have adjusted that first year had it not been for you. So thank you seriously for everything that you have done for me and for this council. I also want to say good luck and best wishes to Councilman Kimball and Councilwoman Craig. I think this is our last, not really our last meeting, but we got one more and then the
sin
die after that. So
we're
winding it down as far as the business that we'll be tackling. So I want to wish you guys certainly the best, and then to the rest that are running for re-election, good luck. And that'll be coming up before our next meeting. So, and then speaking of the election, we have a lot of citizens groups that participate and really get involved in the process. And for that regard, I'd like to say thank you to a couple of groups that have invited every candidate, whether you're seeking re-election, your first time in office, whatever the case may be. They've been very generous. We had the Greater Gaston Tea Party, the Gaston Democratic Party. We had the Sherwood Community Watch. We've had the African-American Conservative of Highland. The Gardner Park is tonight. Of course, we could not attend that one. But these groups opened up their doors and invited candidates in so that citizens, residents, could hear what potential candidates that would be serving them would have to say. So I want to thank them, and also a thank you to Firestone Grill, Lucky Samurai, and Butler Art Studios, who opened their doors to allow me to hold a Talk of the Town meeting, which is just about city business, residents coming in, and they were nice enough to open their establishments. So I did want to say thank you to them as well. And really, that is the only report I have, but I did want to ask a question. I guess it was primarily due to Mr. Kistler's comments at the public comment period. And I guess to you, Councilman Curlin, because you sit on the Parks and Rec Advisory Committee, it's my understanding that obviously there's been some conversation with the city because the Grizzlies want a new ballpark, but we're not involved with any new ballpark, are we? At this point, I mean, there's just been discussion. Mr. Kistler's not the first one I've heard this from, so I'm like, is there something going on that I don't know about? Because we're not involved in a ballpark at this point, are we?
There are very informal discussions going on by a group of community citizens that are interested in, you know, promoting the possibility of a ballpark. Mr. Munn has been in on these conversations. I have been unable to attend the meetings because of the time of day. But, before anything gets started, you have to take an idea and then you have to start to work with it. So it's very early. I mean, there's been no projected timetable, funding sources, conceptually, I think it's a great idea. And of course, as Ms. Craig said, that I've said in the past, the devil's in the details. So, I would never, reject any idea that comes forward. But unfortunately, a lot of the public is not well informed. There's a lot of hearsay. And, things get said, that just are untrue because, they don't get it from a reliable source. So I would say at this point, all talks are preliminary. If I had more to report, I would certainly would. Okay. There has never been, to this point in time, a report given to the Recreation Advisory Commission, who is the, the public arm of the Recreation Department. So you can see how premature and early it is in the discussion phase. But I think there'll be things coming forward that will be public and get this process started. But, anything of this magnitude is going to obviously have to involve a lot of different parties, both private and public. So,
okay. Thank you. Like I said, I've heard a couple things lately. I thought, did I miss something? Is it moving along?
No.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Sure.
That is it, sir.
Okay, Mr. Thank you, sir. Mr. Gallagher.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Jenny, thank you for being there when I first came on in 2011 and handling my panic phone calls to find out what's going on and where I have to be, when I have to be. And, really, I know they have training at UNC. Charlotte has training every 4 years for the new candidates and stuff like that. But you were, as everyone else has said, been gracious and very kind and never had a harsh word. And I just appreciate you so much. And thank you for all that you've done and do and did. And enjoy your life a leisure now, Thank you. Public power. Michael was excellent. Blade, Ron, you got all the guys together and brought it out there at the East Ridge Mall. That was fantastic. Had an opportunity to do many things there. They teaching kids about safety with transformers and not trying to be, as kids are naturally, have a penchant to investigate or dare somebody. That was really nice to have that because bad things can happen if kids get close to transformers, and I just appreciate that. And you're right, Ed. The thing about the squirrels, where they show you the video cameras and the zap,
That was very, there was a line to get in to see that. Anyway. Also went to the 100-year Cramerton celebration, and I represented the city of Gastonia. It was very nice. They did an excellent job. It went on for 3 days. I was just there for Saturday. It was got very hot in the afternoon. Took a break and then went to Stuart Kramer from 4 to 6. They had a play. They did a play on the Mill Village itself and how life and times was it, you know, and all. They were students from the Stuart Kramer themselves, and they did an excellent job. Also, did we ever freeze pay for the public service or for any employees in 2011, 2000, you know, since we've been here? I thought they've gotten raises, or we were able to give the employees some type of bonuses or so.
If you go back to the previous council, there was a freeze, and then with this council, we started in gently with bonuses. And we did bonuses the first 2 years. The last 2 years, we've applied actually pay. This past year was the 3.5% on an average that was fully embedded into the pay. And also, in this past year, we had the highest percentage for the lowest paid employee. And that would go up because we based it on a percentage of pay and a fixed amount. So that way, the people with the very lowest pay would get 4.5% or more. You get, by the time you're at the upper pay ranges, it might be 1%. So we tried to load it more for people who work for us and have lower incomes. And so for the last 2 years, we've worked on that. And each year, we have been able to increase the rate that we've given our employees in terms of pay. And it's been and if you really want to blame something, it's the recession. It flatlined our pay. It caused the pay to not move at a rapid rate. When you look at the history of pay increases, you can see that right before the recession, it was just moving right along, and then bang, stops. And that happened with Gastonia, and it happened with a lot of cities. And in the private sector, it happened there, and some of those companies went gone. They're out. So when a hard recession hits the city employees feel it, the ratepayers feel it, the taxpayers feel it. We all get hit hard with a recession. And this recession was longer than any of the others that we've ever had, because we would have the little recessions and you'd hit down, but then you'd pick it up pretty well. But this one didn't move like that. That long, it wiped out so many companies in the home building, real estate, and so jobs just really weren't available and money was really reduced. So, but we've gotten better each year we've made it better. And next year, we hope we'll make it even better yet. So because the Gastonia itself and Gaston County and this country we're coming out of the recession. Times are getting better. But you have to work at it. It's the water and sewer. It's the transportation. It's being smart about your land use. It's growing your city and taking advantage. Fortunately, we're in this big metropolitan region. But as we grow, and we do well, then our employees do well. And so that hopefully this coming year will even be better.
Excellent. So we haven't instituted any freeze. It was the council prior to us, and we've helped the employees in terms of pay. Thank you. I appreciate that. And that is it, Mr. Mayor. I know elections are coming up, and I just want to wish everyone good luck with it. And you know, don't forget, vote for Jim Gallagher. Anyway. Thank you very much.
Dr. Fairley, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would say, let's just everybody get out and vote.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's probably most important. Mayor Pro Tem described Jenny Creighton initially, and she used the word sweet. And I said, That was the word I was going to use, you know? Because this woman is, I mean, she is sweet beyond compare, you know? I've never heard her utter even the bit of dissension, you know? I don't know where the gene pool came from, Jenny, but God bless you. You've been just such a wonderful person, just a quiet, you know, soldier, just there supporting every staff member, supporting every council person, supporting every mayor, every manager, you know, just kind of quietly there. Dependable, kind, compassionate, and for the most, you know, most of all, you know, professional, truly a professional person. So we're going to miss you. We love you. We want you to come back, but take 30 days mandatory, okay? but come back, you know, we've got a part-time position for you. I just haven't told Mr. Bunn yet, but, you know, we'll find it. And we just wish you the best of luck. And I just hope this next chapter of your life is just full of all kinds of wonderful, meaningful experiences, because that's what retirement should be all about. And that's all I got.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings.
Thank you. Jenny, you know, all what my colleagues have said, but you always did it with a smile, and that's it's fantastic. And you're another person. Can't stump you with a question. You pretty much do everything, and I think that's a great thing. But thank you again, and happy retirement. Just wanted to give a little shout out to Charlie Craig. Many of you know him. He's got the restored Sinclair station on South New Hope Road. His car show that benefits cancer services was rained out, and Charlie went ahead in Charlie fashion and rescheduled it. And a tremendous amount, the car show fields were full. All benefited cancer services of Gaston County, and he did a fantastic job. Great event. The second one was a real good day. Also, obviously, because it's National Breast Cancer Awareness Month. But it's also, there's another issue this month that's also very important. This is also National Cybersecurity Awareness Month. And there's, on the internet, there's a number of quick bullet points that folks can go on and look at that'll hopefully help them to be less of a victim of cyber fraud. So that's out there this month, and I think it's a great tool. Ash, got a quick question for you.
Is this the stump part?
I don't think so. You have answered this already.
See, that's been the goal all this time, is to ask a question to stump people, all right, Walter?
Never. With all that's being said with these ride-sharing groups now that are kind of going head-to-head with the traditional taxis, Uber, Lyft, where are we seeing any? Are we seeing any regulatory actions, either through our state or anything like that, that maybe you can share real briefly,
or
maybe give a report, maybe at the Transportation Committee meeting, because I think that's going to be something that is going to be on our radar screen.
I'd be glad to do that. The next Transportation Committee, there was comprehensive legislation passed this session by the General Assembly. So basically, they've preempted the field, and we won't have to regulate it. The only thing, we may hear some pushback from our taxi industry, which we do regulate.
Right.
But the General Assembly did adopt pretty much comprehensive stuff for Uber and Lyft, and we expect materials to be coming through the Attorneys Association and the Police Attorneys Association to understand how to enforce those.
Thank you, sir. Last thing, coming up for our transportation meeting, we had Mr. Graham Bell came here, I guess it was about a month or so ago, regarding the public comment. He had some ideas. Ed, can we make sure that we have those transcribed or we're able to review those at our transportation meeting? I know that, Todd, you had mentioned those, and I want to make sure that we get those in their entirety, because rather than leaving it up to just some casual note-taking. If we could do that from the public expression, I think it was 2 or 3 meetings ago.
Right. Yeah, and I think primarily what Graham was talking about was the extension of the Garden Parkway that goes from I-85 going north up near Thornburg Road, I think, up on
321,
okay,
exactly where that alignment. And that's always been part of the thoroughfare plan. And that was, and it's an important connection to do. It's also an expensive connection. And but to be able to take that traffic from 321 and
right,
take it over to Spartanburg and get it out of that mix that we have right there at 321 is a good idea. And so he was describing that, but what we can do is get all that information for the committee and also have the maps too, so the committee can see exactly what he's talking about. And he'll be at the meeting.
Oh, that's what I was just going to ask you, if we could proffer an invitation to him.
I think, Michael, you talked to him, so Graham's going to actually be at the meeting.
I did not know that. Okay, thank you, sir. That's all I have, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mrs. Creighton. Good afternoon, City Manager's Office. May I help you? How many times have we heard that?
Oh, now,
she got a little tired of hearing me answer too late. Nah, too late. No. Beyond help. She got a little tired of that, I'm sure. I'll echo everything that everyone else said. I like his idea about coming back, you know, after 30 days, Dr. Curlins. But you've been tremendous asset, as I said, and we think the world of you, and we're here, so for you. Greater Gastonia Development Corporation had a big thing over meeting at in Belmont, and they came from regional York County and Catawba, and Mecklenburg and Union, and all of them. And Walt, it's interesting, Brian, all the speakers that we had there. One of them asked, how many, and it was a big crowd. He said, how many of you, just a show of hands, how many came today, drove by yourself? And that was 90% of us, just raise your hand. And so that was a good point, and that's it, following up exactly with what y'all were talking about there. That was a week ago today, that meeting. Also, I think that there's one other thing that I didn't, I'll get to it later, but that I was going to tell you about. But anyway, congratulations to the, 5-0 to the Gastonia Panthers. I mean, they're rather wonderful. And so 5-0. Well,
we could adopt worse things.
The man always says we're going to annex Charlotte.
We're going to annex Charlotte. That's right. So, okay. I think that's it, ladies and gentlemen, and it's that all I can think of, but it's 8:30, so it's quitting time. That's right. Thank you very much for being here, everyone.